Everyone, this is Shobha from CNS, and we are here on the first day of the fourth summit of APCAT, Asia Pacific Cities Alliance for Tobacco Control and Prevention of NCDs. And today we are in conversation with Auriella Rojani, Director of Partnership for Healthy Cities at Vital Strategies. Welcome, Auriella.
Thank you, Shobha.
Tell us something more about what is this Partnership for Healthy Cities about.
Absolutely. And thank you so much for the opportunity to speak to you about the Partnership for Healthy Cities.
Yes.
We are a network of over 50 cities around the world working to prevent non-communicable diseases and injuries. We launched the partnership in 2017 after Michael Bloomberg was named the World Health Organization Global Ambassador for NCDs and Injuries. So the network really speaks to his interests and his beliefs that cities are the way forward for health specifically, and that NCDs and injuries are the leading issues of our generation and we need to be addressing them now. So the spirit of the partnership is very much, what can we do now on NCD and injury prevention to make a difference in years to come? And the way that we work with cities is by selecting one of the proven interventions as discovered by, or as named by the World Health Organization. We're supporting cities to implement one of these proven interventions without delay. These interventions range from tobacco control to food policy to improving data collection on NCDs and to road safety, as well as several other areas. But they really are the leading causes of death around the world, and we're pleased to work in over 50 cities and with over 50 mayors to actually get this done.
Okay, and how many countries do these 50 cities span? How many countries are there?
That's a great question. I think we're at 41 countries now, and we're growing at the moment.
So can you share some best practice examples of these cities?
Absolutely. We have a lot of cities that are making tremendous progress, even in the last 2 years that we've been working with them, but often dating well before that around these issues. So one of the best practices that I like to bring up is actually here in Indonesia. The city of Bandung is doing great work in increasing the enforcement around their smoke-free regulations. So the city is taking what was, I would say, infrequent enforcement and making it a regular part of the activities of what the cities do. And that's exactly what we're asking for, is for cities to be regular and consistent about their public health activities. I also like to talk about the city of Montevideo in Uruguay in Latin America. They have been quite strong on non-communicable disease prevention for years. And what the city has done is around reducing salt consumption, because hypertension is a big problem in Uruguay. And so the city has passed regulations that take salt shakers and condiments like ketchup and soy sauce off the table, and so that salt is not added to the food unnecessarily. And then most recently adopted a regulation providing that 10% of all food and sold in restaurants and bars has to be salt-free or no salt added. So there are a lot of examples like this where cities have used their regulatory capacity for public health goods, and that's exactly what we'd like to see more of going forward.
Okay, so since its initiation, this partnership, it has helped advance tobacco control.
Absolutely.
And also control and prevent NCDs. What more can be done, or what are the challenges which the cities may be facing on ground level?
I don't know how much time you have to talk about challenges, but it's a great question.
Yes.
You know, I think some of the challenges that plague non-communicable diseases and injury prevention are the same kind of challenges that any other issue might face or any city would face. Budget constraints, changing political agendas, a lack of public understanding, and competing priorities. You know, when a mayor hears from their constituents, what do they usually hear about? Traffic. Or sanitation and trash. So one of the challenges that we have in particular is putting these issues on the agenda of political leaders and getting their support for these issues. But you know, I feel very positive about the momentum that we're making. I think this summit is a great example of how much progress has been made already. The partnership is really pleased to work with the union and APCAT to accelerate that progress. We're working very closely together and to continue to support the cities on tobacco control going forward. You know, I think the goal goal is to build the capacity of the public health departments or health departments or mobility departments in every city around the world, mm-hmm. so that what we're doing on tobacco control can be transferred over to other areas of NCD prevention. So if a health inspector is going to a restaurant and checking that there's nobody smoking inside, equally they can check if there's advertisements for sugary drinks or if sugary drinks are being sold to kids, mm-hmm. and really support the whole infrastructure around NCD prevention.
So it's also about breaking the silos and bringing in together different issues.
Exactly.
So what do you have to say about like platforms like Partnership for Healthy mm-hmm. Cities and EpiCat, which is again an alliance of mayors? Do you think that this local action will actually feed into the global agenda mm-hmm. of working on the SDGs, which is the aim of all countries?
That's a great question. So exactly that. One of the things we tried to do, both through the Partnership for Healthy Cities as well as through EpiCat, is to bridge the divide between global policy and the Sustainable Development Goals with local action, mm-hmm. and to demonstrate that cities and city leaders have as much of a responsibility and as much ownership over achieving the targets of the SDGs as national governments do. And the way to do that is to really just show your progress and to do something about it. You know as well as I do that there's a lot of talk in the global agenda, and we, along with EpiCat and other networks like this, support a lot of action on the ground. So it's what can we do now? And it doesn't have to be something huge. It can be an incremental step towards, you know, a robust public health system. But what can we do now to actually get us towards meeting those SDG targets and goals or local health outcome targets? Mm-hmm.
Your message for this fourth summit of EpiCat?
Well, I have several, but thank you. That's a good question. I think what's most important is that I first want to thank all of the leaders and all of the cities who are participating here. I mean, it's always wonderful to see the kind of support and commitment that everybody from the top down, within the government and outside of the government, has for these sorts of issues. I think the message that I have is to keep the commitment up, to really embrace a collaborative attitude within the city, but also with other cities, to share best practices, and then to continue to raise this issue, you know, amongst the general public, to start, you know, continue to speak publicly about this at every opportunity so that people are aware of the good work that's happening.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shobha.
Friends, we were in conversation with Aurelia Rojani, Director of Partnership for Healthy Cities at Vital Strategies. And you can follow this fourth EpiCat Summit, which is going on social media under the hashtag EpiCat2019. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Shobha.
Thank you.